Hello viewers, today we will talk about the basics of waveguide and propagation in a parallel plane waveguide. In this lecture, we will first give the introduction of waveguide and the mode of propagation inside waveguide which are possible, parallel plane waveguide working and the characteristics of waveguide. First, we give the introduction that at frequencies above 3 gigahertz, transmission of electromagnetic energy along the transmission line and cables become difficult due to higher attenuation. In the transmission line, various types of losses are there, and one of the loss is radiation loss, and this radiation loss is higher when the dimension of the transmission line is become comparable to the wavelength. So, at the gigahertz frequencies, the wavelength is only 3 centimeter. So, the signals starts to radiate before it propagate. The losses that occur in the solid dielectric, which may use in the coaxial cable between the two conductors, is also becomes very high, because the frequencies at 3 gigahertz very rapidly polarize and depolarize the dielectric materials. So, high heat will be produced in that one. So, these losses are become very high. So, the coaxial cable and transmission lines are not capable to propagate the EM energy at gigahertz frequencies. So, the solution of this, a metallic tube can be used to transmit the electromagnetic waves above 3 gigahertz frequencies. Especially the waveguide, a metallic closed conductor that is called waveguide, as its name indicates that it guides the wave. General concept that if you can't beat, then it is wise to join them. The waveguide is working on this principle. Instead of flowing the energy by applying some voltage and current, first immediately we convert the signal in terms of the EM wave and we guide the wave using a waveguide. So, now the problem of radiation have been overcome automatically, because the signal is processed and transmitted in the form of wave itself. So, in waveguide, the hollow metallic tube is used to guide the EM energy from one point to another, or through which the EM wave propagates. Typically, one enclosed conductor filled with an insulating medium, or it may be a dielectric medium. Generally, the air is used between the waveguides, but when the power level is required high, we can use the another dielectric materials whose dielectric strength is high. Generally, the plastic, teflons and these materials are filled inside the waveguide to increase the power level of the waveguide. So, transmission of EM energy along the waveguide travels at a velocity slower than EM energy. In case of waveguide, we have bounded the wave. So, the wave is restricted only inside the waveguide. So, it have to follow the boundary conditions which are exist on a metallic surface. So, in that process, the wave becomes slower. Instead of moving the wave straight forward, the wave is bounce left and right and top and bottom of the conductor. So, the wave is following a zigzag path. So, the net velocity in the forward direction of the wave is slower. The basic features of a waveguide is, the waveguide may use to carry the energy between the pieces of equipment over long distances, to carry the transmitter power to an antenna to microwave signals, especially the radar signals which are in the gigahertz frequency ranges. The power level of the signals are very high. So, to connect the transmitter and to the radar antenna, the waveguides are used. Waveguides are made from copper, aluminium or brass, and these metals are fabricated to form a rectangular or circular pipes. Electromagnetic energy to be carried by a waveguide is injected into one end of the waveguide. So, in this hollow conductor, one side we insert the probe, and from the generator the wave is coming, immediately convert the EM wave, and from one side the waveguide is sorted, and then the energy starts to flow in the opposite direction. The electric and magnetic fields associated with the signal bounces off inside walls back and forth as it progresses down the waveguide. The waveguide is working above a certain frequency, that depends upon the dimension of the waveguide. In that way, the waveguide is working as a high pass filter. That means the waveguide do not support the frequencies below a critical frequency, and the critical frequency is depends upon the dimension of the waveguide. That is called the cutoff frequencies. Types of waveguides which are used is rectangular waveguide, circular waveguide, and the rectangular waveguide is further classified in terms of the range and flux. The various types of waveguides are shown in picture. The most common form of waveguide is rectangular waveguide. The cross section of this is rectangle, and the signal is propagated along the length of the waveguide. Circular waveguide, its cross section is a circle, and it is a cylindrical form. It supports especially the circular polarized waves. The dielectric material is filled inside the rectangular conductor, then it is called dielectric waveguide. It may or may not be made by the conductor. Sometimes the whole rectangular waveguide is made of only dielectric materials, but they can support the frequencies in the optical frequency ranges. The well-known example of a dielectric waveguide is the optical fiber that support the optical signals. So, it is not necessary that any waveguide is always made up of conductor. It can be a dielectric materials. The optical fibers are made up of silica, and they support the optical signals. The transmission of EM wave inside the waveguide is in the form of quasi TEM mode. The TEM mode, that is transverse electromagnetic waves, is supported by the transmission line like coaxial cable or two parallel plane transmission lines. But in case of waveguide, the absence of the center conductor, there is no current flow in the direction of propagation. So, the excitation or the TEM mode is not possible. The possible mode in case of waveguide is transverse electric or transverse magnetic. So, either the magnetic field is in the direction of propagation or the electric field must be in the direction of propagation, then only the wave is possible inside the waveguide. Further, let me see that the rectangular waveguide, as I told that its cross section is a rectangular, its maximum length is generally considered along the x axis, that is denoted in the figure by A, and height of the waveguide is denoted by B. It is considered generally the y axis, and the wave is considered to be flow in the z direction, that is along the length of the conductor. The wall of the guides are conductors, and therefore the reflection from them may take place. These rectangular waveguides are used to support the high power at millimeter waves, and these are used in the radar and satellite communications, and especially when the high frequency or gigahertz frequency measurements are to be take place in the experimental and research work, we use these rectangular. Generally, the x axis dimensions are considered higher. The another form of waveguide, that is circular waveguide, and is, as I shown, that its radius is equal to a, and it is just like a metallic cylinder. It supports the transverse electric and transverse magnetic modes, and the circular waveguides are capable to support circularly polarized waves. The circular polarized waves are especially used for satellite communications, and they are also used for some microwave components like isolators and attenuators when some specific materials are inserted in the waveguide. The rectangular waveguides are also modified by inserting some ridge or some dip on the top side. The advantage of this kind of rectangular waveguide is that they can support somewhat lower frequencies than the corresponding plane rectangular waveguides. These waveguides are capable to then handle the frequencies below the microwave frequency, which are the VHF and UHF frequencies most commonly used in the television signals. The propagation modes, as I told, that three types of modes are possible: the transverse electromagnetic waves, transverse electric waves, and transverse magnetic waves. So, in case of waveguide, the possible modes are TE mode. In case of TE mode, the electric field is transverse or perpendicular to the direction of propagation, but the magnetic fields is having a component along the direction of propagation. In case of TM mode, the magnetic field is perpendicular to the direction of propagation, and the electric field have one component that is in the direction of propagation. And sometimes we may have the hybrid mode. In that case, both electric and magnetic field component are also exist along the direction of propagation. When the wave is propagated inside the waveguide, the electric field and magnetic field establish in a form, and a pattern of EM fields is established inside the waveguide. Particular pattern of a waveguide is we can found by solving the Maxwell equations inside the waveguide, and particular EM field configurations have been shown in this figure. We can see that the electric field is bounces between the top and bottom, and it is vertically and downward. The magnetic fields are encircling the electric field lines. They are shown by the red ones, and the electric field are shown by the blue lines. So, here the magnetic field is also in the plane of the direction of propagations. So, it is called the TE mode. And in this case, we can see that the electric field is bounces from this left hand side wall, and it come back to the same one. Similarly, in the right hand side wall, the field is started and coming back. So, if we try to see the component of electric field, it also has some in the direction of propagation. Again, the magnetic fields are encircling the electric field lines. So, in this case, we can see the magnetic field is perpendicular to the direction of propagation. So, this field is supporting the transverse magnetic mode. To explain the principle of wave propagation inside the waveguide, we can start with a parallel plane waveguide. In case of parallel plane waveguide, there are two parallel planes of conductors, either in the horizontal direction or in vertical directions. Although these kind of waves are practically not used, because it is difficult to support the two parallel planes which are isolated by some distance, but it is easy to explain the working or propagation of waveguide inside the hollow conductor. So, we start with a parallel plane waveguide. These are the two conductor planes which are separated by some distance. So, we can see that when the field is incident on one wall with some angle, then it reflected and it is bounces off between the conductor and progress toward the length of waveguide. So, when a probe is launched, the energy inside the waveguide, the electromagnetic fields bounces off the side walls of the waveguide as shown in this diagram. The angle of incidence and reflection depends upon the operating frequency. At high frequency, the angles are large and therefore, the path between the opposite walls is relatively long. So, when the wave is bounces off, then the path covered by the EM waves is depends upon the operating frequency. We can see that when the frequency is high, the angle of incidence is lower and the wave is tried to be become parallel with the line and it covered a smaller distance. But in case of medium frequency and in low frequencies, the bounces is rapidly, and especially when the frequency is below the cutoff frequencies, the wave is bouncing back and forth at the same point and it is not capable to propagate along the line. To understand the propagation of EM wave inside the waveguide, we can explain the process in few steps, and let me first represent the wavefront in terms of the parallel lines. The figure B shows the wavefronts. Here the darker one shows the maxima and the smaller or thinner line represent the minima. So, the wavefront when it progresses, it have the maxima and minima. The bold lines represent the positive or plus E 0 and the minus E 0 is represented by lighter lines. Inside the waveguide, there we consider air. So, the wave propagate at a velocity is represented by U, where U is subscripted indicated unbounded waves here, because the wave inside only in between the conductor is air media is there, and when it is unbounded, the velocity is equal to the light velocity. Next, we consider the another TEM wave front. That wave front is incident with some angles, and I shown this in figure A. One wave front is incident with angle theta and the another wave front is incident with angle of minus u theta, and if these two TEM wave front is excited at simultaneously inside the waveguide, then the two wave fronts are combined and we can get a pattern of as shown in figure B. So, the waves are combined as shown in figure B. Notice that the horizontal lines can be drawn on the superposed waves that correspond to the zero fields. We can see that on this horizontal lines, the maxima of one front wave front is meets with the minima of the another wave fronts. If these two wave fronts having the equal magnitude, we can see that on these lines, these are the points where the field is zero or node points are there. Similarly, in between these two lines, here we can see that the minima of both the wave fronts or maxima of the wave fronts are meeting. So, they are working as the antinodes. So, we can see that there are different parallel lines are there. On all these lines, we always have the minima or the electric field or magnetic field is zero at that as those lines. When the field is zero, that is the property of a conductor. In a conductor, the electric field is zero. So, if I put a waveguide at these lines, then the configuration or pattern of these wavefronts do not change. The same principle is used in the waveguide. We put two parallel planes along these two lines. The separation of these two parallel plane waveguide can be at these two lines, it can be between these two pairs, or it can be like this one. But at least the minimum separation between the two conductors must be equal to this one, where only a single antinode is exist. So, these are the zero total field lines are there. when we put a conductor at these places, the field its property do not change. Using this diagram, if as I told that these are the two conductors we have placed at the two lines where the zero fields are there. So, and in between the lines the wave fronts are propagating. So, from this diagram we can see that this is the antinode and this is the node. That means, when we draw the pattern of a field line, the distance between the node and antinode is lambda by 2. So, at this point the field is 0, this is another point the field is 0. So, from this trigonometric diagram of or the triangle ABC, we can see that sin theta is equal to this perpendicular distance divided by the hypotenuse, and let the separation of the two line is A. So, sin theta is coming out m times of n is an integer. So, it is m times of lambda by 2 divided by A, and from this expression we can see that lambda is coming out 2 A by m multiplied by sin theta. The wavelength here is function of theta, that is the incident angle of the wave, and when sin theta is 1, that means the 90 degree incident angle is there, the lambda will be maximum and the corresponding frequency is minimum that can be support. At that time, when the theta is 90 degree, that is the ultimately limit when the wave front is bounces only at the same point. So, from this expressions we can decide the cutoff frequency, or lambda c is the critical frequency that exists when theta is 90 degree. We can express the lambda c, as I told that it is sin theta equal to 1. So, the lambda c, that a cutoff frequency is coming out 2 twice of the dimension between the two conductor divided by m. M is the integer, it can be 1, 2 like this one. When it is 1, the lambda is maximum. When it is 2, the lambda is smaller wavelength means higher frequency. That means, above the cutoff frequencies, the waveguide is capable to support its harmonics. So, the minimum value of M where the lambda is maximum, this is also called the dominating mode of propagation where the wavelength is maximum. How a wave is moving inside the waveguide, that we can explain in terms of the different types of velocity. From this diagram again we can explain that when the wave front is moving, the time taken to move the wave front between the point A to C is given by m times of lambda by 2, that is the distance, divided by the velocity, that is the speed of the wave in the unbounded media. So, it is coming out m lambda by 2 divided by the speed inside this one. Similarly, the time taken to process the waveguide along the length from point A to this is the wave front. So, on this line and on this line the phase is same. So, the distance AD is, we can express the time taken to cover the distance AD is m lambda divided by cos theta times of the phase velocity. The velocity along this line or along the boundary, that is represented up, and actual direction of moving is represented by unbounded velocity. So, when the wave is moving from point A to D, it is moving with the phase velocity up, and when it moving along the path AC, it is moving by the unbounded velocity. If you try to put the value of cos theta from the previous expression, the sin theta is given by this. So, the phase velocity is coming out unbounded velocity divided by cos theta. Cos theta is 1 minus sin square theta under root of this. So, we can express the phase velocity as unbounded velocity divided by 1 minus the cutoff frequencies and the operating frequencies whole square. This expression shows that the phase velocity will becomes more than the unbounded velocity for all frequencies, because here fc is the lowest frequency and the f is operating frequency that is possible above fc. So, this factor is always less than 1. So, the phase velocity is always higher than the unbounded velocity, that is the light velocity. We can also define the group velocity, that is the actual advancement of the wave in the forward direction, that is represented in diagram by ug. So, to find out the ug, we can see that this ug is nothing but the horizontal component of the unbounded velocity along the direction of propagations. So, the unbounded velocity, as I told, it is the free space velocity, that is the light velocity divided by the dielectric constant of the material, that is ur and epsilon r. So, when we express this ug in terms of the unbounded velocity, the component is coming out unbounded velocity multiplied by cos theta. Again, we have the value of cos theta is under root 1 minus sin square theta. So, the group velocity is coming out unbounded velocity multiplied by a factor. Again, this factor, as I told, that it is always less than 1. So, the group velocity is always lower than the unbounded velocity. The group velocity is phase velocity, and unbounded velocity we can explain or understand by the analogy of the wave front that is moving in the water. The diagram shows that the two wave fronts are moving. So, we can see that advancement of the wave front in the forward direction is represented by the group velocity. The inclined movement of the wave front is given by the unbounded velocity, and the movement of the wave along the beach is represented by phase velocity. Actually, the phase velocity is not a material velocity, no particle is moving, it is the change of phase only. So, it is a virtual velocity, sometimes we can call this phase velocity is always greater than or equal to the light velocity, but the group velocity is always less than the free space velocity. The relation between the group velocity and phase velocity we can see from the previous, and we found that the product of the group velocity and phase velocity is equal to c square. So, from this expression, when V p is greater than c, always the group velocity is less than the light velocity. Inside the waveguide, the wavelength is different than the free space wavelength. So, we can express the bounded wavelength in terms of the phase velocity multiplied by free space wavelength divided by the c, V p is the phase velocity. So, we can put the value of V p from the previous expression. We found that the bounded wavelength is given by lambda 0 divided by the factor under root 1 minus f c by whole square. So, this factor is always less than 1. So, the lambda is higher than the free space wavelength. When the lambda is higher, that means the wave inside the waveguide is moving by slow velocity. In today's lecture, we have discussed the basic working of waveguides, and then we explain the process that how the wave is moving inside the waveguide.